Hi, I'm Dr. Leslie Williams, and this quick tutorial is going to cover the capsule stain, which is also covered in exercise 11 of your lab manual. So what is the purpose of a capsule stain? Well, let's say that I give you a plate of a bacterial species that was cultured from somebody suffering a bacterial infection. And you want to know, does this species make a capsule? Well, why is that important at all? Well, it turns out that encapsulated bacteria can be particularly formidable pathogens because the capsule makes it more difficult for an infected person's immune system to actually fight and control the infection. So knowing if you're dealing with an encapsulated species or not can have some clinical significance. So one way that you can test for the presence of a capsule is actually to just look at the plate. Bacterial species such as Klebsiella pneumoniae that make really robust capsules, meaning they make really thick capsules, when they grow up on certain types of media and they produce these capsules, the cultures themselves end up looking kind of goopy and wet. So if you take an inoculating loop and you kind of pull out on one of those colonies, you can see that there's actually like a goop string in there, and that's from the capsule. So capsulated colonies tend to be very goopy and slimy looking. But that's not a surefire way to determine if something is in fact capsulated. So a better way is to do what is known as a capsule stain. The first thing that we're going to do is cover the theory of how a capsule stain is performed. So let's watch a tutorial on that. The capsule stain requires two different dyes, Congo red and carbofuchsin. In addition, we need a fixing agent, which is acid alcohol. So it turns out that the capsules on the bacteria don't absorb stains at all. So how can we view them using a stain? Well, the way that we're going to view the capsules is by staining everything else, including the background. So we start with Congo red, and we smear our Congo red liquid solution all over the slide. This effectively paints the slide kind of a light pink, so it paints the background. Then we're going to take some of our culture, which includes capsulated bacteria, and mix it thoroughly with the Congo red, spreading the bacteria around. Then we allow it to air dry. If you were to look at the slide under a microscope at this point, what you would see are white spaces where all the bacteria and their capsules are. So the next thing that we're going to do is add acid alcohol to the slide to fix it. What this does is create a tighter bond between the Congo red, the cells, and the glass to kind of keep everything in its place. Once acid alcohol has sat on the slide for 15 seconds, we can rinse it all off with water. Next, we're going to apply a counter stain. The counter stain is carbofuchsin, and carbofuchsin will stain the vegetative cells kind of a dark pink. So now what we're going to do is take a look at our slide under a microscope, and what we'll see is this. The background will be the Congo red, it's kind of a light pink. The vegetative cells are going to be the dark purple, either cocci or bacillus, and then the white spaces are going to be the capsule. So the capsules are not stained, but everything else is. So this image here shows a real picture of a successful capsule stain. Surprisingly, they're actually rather difficult to do. Not every student does them successfully. But this is a successful capsule stain viewed at 1,000 times magnification. So what are we looking at here? Well, let's blow up this image just a little bit and see if we can identify some parts. So the first thing to identify is, where is the Congo red that stains the background? Well, it's here. Notice it's actually not red, but more of a light pink color. Now we need to identify the vegetative cells. The vegetative cells are stained with carbofuchsin, and I have identified one right there. Now, the only thing that's left are these white halos. The white halos are the capsules. So capsule stains are sometimes referred to as negative stains. A negative stain is where you stain everything else but what you're looking for. Because the capsules do not absorb the dyes, everything else is stained, and what you're really interested in looking at, in this case the capsule, shows up as a white halo. It's the only thing on here that is not stained. So now that we've identified the parts of this picture, let me show you another one. In this one, you should take some time to copy down one or both of these images into your lab manual. When you do so, identify the background, which is Congo red, the vegetative cells, which are stained with carbol fuchsin, and the capsule, which is the white halo. Go ahead and pause the video until you are done copying down these images in your lab manual. All right, now that you're done, let's briefly talk about some of these discussion questions. So I mentioned already that capsule stains are referred to as negative stains. The phrase negative stain means that everything else gets stained but what you're looking at. In this case, the capsule stain is going to stain the background and the cells so that only the capsule remains unstained. So let me ask you this. If you had a culture of a bacterial species that did not produce a capsule, so this is non-encapsulated bacteria, and you were to do a capsule stain, what would you see? Well, you wouldn't see any white. You would simply see the light pink Congo red background and dots that represent the vegetative cells stained a little bit darker with carbol fuchsin, but there would be no white halo around them. So that would be the result of a capsule stain for a non-encapsulated bacteria. I mentioned at the start of this tutorial that capsulated bacteria can actually cause us some problems if they're infecting us. They are clinically important because capsules are a virulence factor. And a virulence factor is going to be some property that makes a pathogen even more pathogenic. In other words, capable of causing more serious or more long-lasting diseases. So, why? Well, it turns out that if you have a bacterial cell that is encoded in a capsule, it becomes really difficult for our immune system to capture that bacterium and eat it. And in fact, there's a whole branch of our immune system that deals with just eating our problems. So bacteria, viruses, fungi, they're all capable of infecting us and causing infections. And one of our major defenses or counter attacks is to use specialized immune cells that collectively are known as phagocytes that go around and eat them up. So you're infected with 10 bacteria, hopefully you've got some phagocytes that act like Pac-Man that are going to go and eat them up and deal with those 10 bacteria. But in order for our immune cell, the phagocyte, to successfully phagocytose, which is enveloping, engulfing, and digesting, or cutting up, the bacterial cell, it first has to get a grip on it. In other words, that phagocyte is going to extend out its cytoplasmic extensions and try to envelop the bacterium. In order to do that, it's got to be able to grab onto something. If the outer layer is a capsule, that's like trying to hold a slippery fish. If you've ever tried to hold a live fish before, they have kind of a slime layer on them that makes it really difficult to grip. And the same thing is true here. If a bacterium is encapsulated, it becomes really difficult to grab it, hold it, and therefore phagocytose it. So what happens is that our ability to eat our problems becomes severely hampered by the capsule. So do we have any counter defense to it? Well, yes, after some time. So let's take a look at one more tutorial that will cover the effect of opsonins, special molecules that help reduce the pathogenicity of capsules. In order for phagocytes to successfully grip a pathogen, there must be something on the outer layer of that pathogen that will bind to these special receptors embedded in the plasma membrane, shown here in blue. Capsules don't really have anything for those blue receptors to grip, so without gripping, they can't do phagocytosis. Opsonins are molecules that are going to help the phagocyte somehow grip or destroy the pathogen. A classic example of an opsonin is going to be an antibody. Antibodies are special immune molecules that we make upon exposure to a particular pathogen, and those antibodies are going to bind to some specific molecule expressed on the surface of the pathogen, in this case, the capsule. So once those antibodies bind to the capsule, notice that the stems are sticking out. Well, the phagocytes, grippers, are going to bind to those stems, and that allows the phagocyte to get a good grip on the pathogen. And when this happens, the phagocyte is able to induce phagocytosis by first extending its cytoplasmic extensions out and enveloping the pathogen. So opsonins are going to be special molecules that are going to help the phagocytes conduct phagocytosis and destroy these encapsulated bacteria. In summary, opsonins, such as antibodies, are going to reduce the pathogenicity of an encapsulated bacterium. Thanks for watching.